Hello, everybody. For those of you listening to this in the future, we are doing this in the middle of coronavirus time. So every single person on this is remote. I'm sitting here in my house, looking at a beautiful view out the window. And I'm just really excited to be doing something and working. And I'm very happy to be helping you guys today with some tips for technical interviews. For those of you who aren't students and don't know my background, I've been a working developer for decades. I'm the co-founder of the Tech Academy along with my co-founder, Jack Stanley. And I'm still a working developer, even as a co-founder of the school. So I try to keep up to speed on what's going on in the technology world. And that includes getting jobs. So I've got a fair bit of experience in that area. So what we're going to try to do is share some tips for technical interviews. Now, I've written this from the point of view of addressing a person who's relatively new to the industry. But frankly, I think the advice here will bear out for anyone at any level of their career, because a lot of the things are the same. So let's just get started. First, I just want you to read this slide. I'm going to give you guys a few minutes to go ahead and look at why we're doing this tech talk. Great. So that's the background of why we're addressing this. It's true. And I'm going to be honest, even as a very experienced developer, I can get nervous about technical interviews. It's never really that fun, I don't think, for anyone to be quizzed on what you know. And that's the first thing I want to address, is that kind of idea of being quizzed about what you know. And we'll cover this a bit more in detail later on, but one of the things you'll find about a technical interview is that's actually a rather minor part of it, is being quizzed about what you know. To be sure, depending on the level of the experience required for the role, they're going to want to know that you've got the chops, that you can code, and that you kind of know what you're talking about. But frankly, a lot of the interview is really just about finding out who you are, how you think, what it looks like in terms of a good fit for that company that you're looking at or that team. And that goes both ways. But we'll dig into that a little bit more. But I just want to stress that for anyone, but particularly when you're new to the industry, this can be kind of a stressful thing. And so we're putting together these tips on technical interviews, hopefully to make it a bit more of an approachable or something you can experience a little more easily. So let's get started. First of all, we're just going to cover a few different types of technical interviews that you might encounter. The first one is a screening interview. Now, a screening interview is usually relatively early on in the process. And it might be a recruiter that does a screening interview. More commonly, even if there's a recruiter involved, it's someone at the company that you're looking to get hired at that's going to do a screening interview. But sometimes this isn't even an IT person. It's a human resources person. Or if it's an IT person, they're IT adjacent, and they're not often a developer. And not always true. Some hiring managers or technology managers do their own screening interviews. But quite often on a screening interview, you see that it's not an IT person. And that's because of its purpose. It's a high-level check to screen out people that are obviously not a fit. Either they really actually don't know how to code, they don't know what they're doing, or they got a really uncomfortable personality, or they might have a lot of experience, but it's really honestly just not the right fit. And so they want to do kind of a gut check right at the beginning of the process, to make sure that neither the candidate or the employer really goes too much farther and wastes time on either side. So if you do well on this, they might give you a coding test as the next step, email it to you, or give you a log on to do or whatever. We'll get into a bit more later on about how to approach those things. But they might very well just bring you right in to the office as the next step. So in terms of a high-level approach to these screening-type interviews, I really want to stress that they're trying to find out who you are. What's your personality like? Are you a personable person? Does it look like you'd be a decent fit just on the surface for the company? Is there any sort of like match between the experience track you have and the primary areas the company operates in? Or if it's not a direct one-to-one match, could they see you getting into their domain, their business area, relatively easily? So that's why personality counts. I highly recommend being interested, and we're going to see this as a hallmark all the way through the talk, being genuinely interested in other people, in the company, in why they're actually hiring for that role, in specific technologies that you find out about. Genuine interest cuts through everything. And it's something that you can't fake it. I can't just tell you, hey, pretend to be interested. It's really something you need to examine within yourself. But it matters all the way through this whole process. So we'll touch on that a little bit later on. The second thing is that unless you're dealing with a highly technical person on this screening interview, which again is not that common, you don't want to go really, really deep on your technical answers. It doesn't mean give them a brush off, but you're not going to want to go way down deep into things for two reasons. One, that's not the purpose of this interview. Or if they do want to go a little more technical than you thought, they'll ask. And the second one is, if you're not dealing with a technology worker on the other end of the phone, you're going to lose them. Frankly, it's a bit talking over their head. Not that they don't know they're talking to a developer. They're going to bring someone on for a technical role. They know they're going to hear a lot of technical terms. But if you go really deep dive on this, I've found, in my own personal experience, you can lose them a bit. Or you end up having to try to explain the technical concept to them, which isn't really the flow or the direction the call is maybe supposed to take. So a little bit of advice. And finally, and it goes back to this personality counts part, whenever you can find a genuine opportunity to tell a story. And I'll give an example. I had an interview, wasn't even the technical part of it, and I was asked a relatively personal question about, tell us about a time where you really messed up on something or had a bit of a snafu, and how did you handle it? They said it can be technical or personal. And so I remembered a time that I had actually, in the middle of a pretty stressful time on a certain project, I was doing a lot of cooperative, development with another developer on. I actually kind of snapped at her one time about a recommendation she gave on an approach. And it really was rude. And it bothered me all day long. And late in the afternoon, I went back to her and I apologized for it. Now, the story I told was a bit longer than that. I'm not going to waste the time with this tech talk with giving you the full thing. But the point is, it was genuine. And honestly, at first glance, it kind of maybe didn't put me in the best light. However, it was true. And so I recommend that sort of an approach. Now, you have to use some tact. You really don't want to make yourself look like a jerk. But in that case, what I was really trying to communicate was, hey, I'm not perfect, man. I don't know who is. But at my heart, I'm a nice guy. And if I hurt someone's feelings or if I'm a bit unprofessional, it matters to me. I'm going to go back and handle it. And that goes back to the fact that it's the personality check, fit check for the company kind of thing. So that's it on screening interviews. Now let's move on to phone interviews. Now, obviously, this screening, to go back for a second, is almost always a phone screen. They'll even call it a phone screen. So this is a phone interview. The difference, it's a much more detailed technical dive. They want to find out about your bona fides. I've got my bona fides. Do you really know what you're talking about? Talk about it a bit, but when they dive deep, do you really know what you're doing? All right, so this kind of an interview is very often assigned to a developer on the team, maybe not the team you're going to go to, although that's pretty common. Right, but a developer at the company, sometimes it's the technical hiring manager or the technology manager that you might be ultimately under if you get hired. Very often, these are done from the script. No one wants to come up with these fresh every single time, so they usually got like a battery of questions they might ask. I've seen it be a relatively loose kind of operation, sometimes extremely organized. Some of the more organized things I've seen is where they've actually got a battery of questions for different experience levels and for different categories of technologies, and they'll literally ahead of time do a pick and choose from all of these and lay out for the interviewer, here's by category what you're going to ask. So it's all spelled out for them. This, of course, is going to be a lot more technical. We'll talk about the approach on that for a second. One thing I want to mention is that when you do well on this technical interview, that generally means that, like, if you did decently, they're going to take you to the next step. Now, the next step can very often mean come on in, right? We want to meet you. And I want to stress that if you've gone through usually a phone screening of some sort and a technical interview, and if it's a technical interview of any length or substance, and you'll probably get a feel for this on the phone call, if they're bringing you in for an in-person interview, whether they tell you right on the phone then or if they get back to you a day or two later, if they're going to bring you in, at that point, it's your job to lose. They're not going to take the resources involved in an in-person visit, which we're going to get to in a moment. and expend them on somebody that they aren't pretty close on, wow, we really like this person. And we'll talk about that more when we talk about the in-person interview in a second. But recognize that when you get done with a pretty thorough technical phone interview, if they have you do the next step, it involves coming into the building, usually that's a really, really good sign. So the high-level approach on these phone interviews, and this is really critical, listen to the person. They can be nerve-wracking. Your attention can be stuck in other places. Your attention needs to be on that person and what they're actually asking. So take the time to really process the question and what they asked. Make sure that you really understand what it is they're asking. And then obviously respond in a genuine manner. Also, another really important thing for these types of interviews, you've got to respect their time. Now, again, a lot of the audience is new to technology. But for those of you who've worked in technology for a while, you'll probably recognize how true this is, and anybody can really understand it. When you're a developer or a member of a technology team of any sort, man, you are busy. There's always a backlog of work to do. There's always something that you're pulling yourself away from to do this technical interview. So respect that. You know, acknowledge it even. Like, it's totally fine to say, hey, I really appreciate you taking time out of your day. And not as some token thing, because that's what people say on interviews, but from a point of understanding of, hey, I'm a technology worker. I really understand, man, you had to, like, leave whatever you were working on. And I know what that means. You may not even say all this out loud, but it'll come through. Anybody who's done any coding knows what it means when you've got this whole mental construct in your head. You're looking at the code on the page, and it's not working the right way, and you're trying to figure out why, and you're like working through all this mental stuff, and something interrupts you, and it all comes crashing down. And then when you come back to it, you've got to rebuild all of that and arrive back to the same point of understanding. Man, that's not fun. And so please just be respectful of the interview time. Now, your time of that interview is really important, and acknowledge that to them. So the final thing is, it's a phone interview. Make sure you express yourself clearly. They can't see you. Think about how your communication is being received on the other end. Consider their point of view. It's always important in any communication in life, but on these phone interviews, it's particularly important. So that's the second technical interview type. Now let's move to the third, an on-site visit. So again, if you've been brought on, even if there wasn't, an on-the-phone technical interview, it was just maybe a phone screen, if you've been brought in, it's going to be a pretty technical, detailed kind of dive into things. And very commonly, if they're bringing you in, they're going to have a group interview. It's relatively uncommon that you come in and there's only one person you're meeting with in the building. That can often be done over the phone, right? Although it does happen. So recognize that you'll be dealing with, a number of different personalities. That can be an intimidating thing. But again, here's the thing, is if they've brought you into their building, you got to recognize they want you to succeed. I got to tell you, I literally cannot remember ever going into an interview where I got any kind of the slightest hint on the other side of the table that anyone there was looking for me to fail or suspected my knowledge level or really thought that their job was to find out how you aren't a fit for the position, especially on the in-person interviews. By the time you've arrived at that point in the process, they want you to get hired. They want you to succeed. For the very pragmatic reason, they've already expended a tremendous amount of internal organizational time and resources to arrive at the point that they're bringing you in and they're all meeting with you. For that reason alone, they're going to want this to work. They're going to want to not have to do it again. But on a personal level, if you've arrived at this point, they probably like you. If they haven't met you, they've heard decent things about you from whoever did the phone screen or whoever did the technical interview, or your recruiter has probably talked you up a fair bit, that kind of thing. They're going to want to like you. And really, the only way this goes badly is if it's your personality that shines through and they're like, wow, I don't really think I like this guy or this girl, and they're probably not going to be a good fit. Yes, there's a technical aspect. You can miss it pretty bad on the technical aspects on this. But I'm telling you, having messed up technical questions in more on-site interviews than I'd care to admit, that's not what they're looking for. They're not trying to figure out that you know everything. And frankly, when there's a thing that you really mess up, if it's handled quote unquote properly, which I'll talk about in a second, it can actually end up being a plus. And the reason for it is that next to the last bullet point, the client, if you got two things. One, what I want to work with this person, and that's a personality fit typically. But more importantly, how does this person think? They want to get inside your head. And when we do the practical, you know, coding example later on, I'll answer some technical coding questions. I'm going to talk through this with specifics, but I just want to stress this point. On our bootcamp program, and especially for those of you, you know, who are on it, you probably know this, we stress pretty heavily working out how to think like a software developer. And much of the way a software developer thinks is influenced by or even directed by how a computer operates. And so they're going to want to know that you think in that same manner, that you can think with an algorithmic approach, with a system approach where something going, you know, sideways over one area can ripple through and cause effects in another area. All these different things, they want to get inside your head, right? So if they've managed to do that and they like what they see, it can overcome all manner of flubbed technical things because they know that you have the right mental approach, that your viewpoint, your attack on a problem is such that even though you might not get the answer right the first time, you're not going to stop. You're going to figure it out, and you have the thinking process and the mental toughness to be able to get through that process. So that's one thing I want to stress about these on-site interviews. Now, another thing, obviously, they might want to see some coding. If they haven't at this point given some kind of coding challenge, they might want to see it. I've seen that done two ways. I've been sat down at an actual computer and here, start coding. Or I've been given a whiteboard and just kind of work it out with pseudocode. So we'll address both of those things. All right, so here's some do's and don'ts for the three types of interviews. On a phone screen, one of the things to do is really do your homework. You need to know that company. You need to figure out what is it about that company that actually interests you. Genuinely, it isn't like, well, it's a job and it pays well and that interests me a lot. So look, every job is like that. First of all, it's not going to be what the hiring person is going to want to hear. Secondly, if that's your sole motivation, man, you got bigger issues. You're going to want to enjoy the work. Be in some way interested in the business domain they operate in or some kind of product they came out with you think is kind of cool or some really interesting challenge to that whole sector of the economy. You're like, wow, you guys are surviving through this. How did you do that? I can't give you a pat answer on what it is that you should be interested in because that's not how interest works. Interest is genuine and it comes from you. And you're going to develop that interest by looking. By looking at the company, by looking at the description given to you by whatever staffing firm may have worked with you, if they did, by looking at the description that you know is in the ad, if the company itself placed their own ad, and you don't want to spend a ton of time on this, you know, initially, especially if you're just going to send the resume out. But by the time you know you've got a phone screen, man, you better do your homework ahead of time. You really should. And if you're doing that, then that last part of that first sentence, have a couple of genuine questions, that's going to come naturally because you're going to have a couple of genuine questions. Like, wow, why did you guys not turn this product into a web-based product until last year? Again, just it's an example. I've seen that before where, you know, I see some initiative they're doing where they've got some console-based application and they've just come out with a web version. This is back in like 2015. And I'm like, you're just now doing that. And I was honestly interested, not as a criticism, because I'm sure there was a reason, and I wanted to know. So that's one of the most important do's on a phone screen, right? And all that, you know, same thing, it covers being interested in listening, right? Another thing, though, to be interested in is why are they hiring for that role? Now, this is a chance to make you look really good, but it's also something you should genuinely be interested in. Like, how do you see me contributing when you bring me on? Like, if you bring me into this role, why are you creating that role? What's driving this? What is the business need that's going on? And the more you can understand that, the more two very important things happen. Because a lot of this thing is about personality, headspace, viewpoint. It's not about technical. I'm going to keep on stressing that throughout this talk. And again, you have to have the technical down. And in a couple minutes here, we're going to be looking at some very technical stuff, okay? But the mental part of it, the personality part of it is just important. So two very important things happen when you really get genuinely interested in why this role, like what's driving this, right? The first one is that they're going to sense your genuine interest, and it's going to increase their, their admiration for you, their interest in you, to increase their communication level. It's all around a good thing because it's genuine, it's real, right? The second thing that happens, though, is you get a much better sense of what the role is like, and it starts to move, if it ever was, out of the area of, well, it's a job and it pays well, and I've heard decent things, to, oh, wow, I can see some specifics. Man, that gets me kind of excited, or I can really get interested in that. Like, I understand why they're driving this, right? And it takes the interview out of this, like, rote, by-the-numbers kind of thing and turns it into a, wow, we're really talking about this. This is a real need you guys have, and I'm really starting to see how I can fit. And then in certain very rare instances, you might see how you're actually genuinely not a fit. And I want to talk about that for just a second. It happens relatively rarely. Usually, your resume and or your relationship with your recruiter and the match with the job description and whatever's being processed, that system works well enough. By the time you arrive at this phone screen or maybe later in a technical interview or whatever, and some at this point, they know if you guys should even be talking. They know if it makes sense. But every once in a while, and it happens more often on this phone screen step, it slips through that, like, wow, I'm really not a fit for this. And how you handle that is extremely important. You want to identify that as early in the process as possible. Don't look for it all the time. Don't be paranoid that, like, oh, I'm probably not a fit for this. It's not what I'm saying. But especially on this thing like a phone screen, or even earlier when you're talking to a recruiter, but on this phone screen, it's important. If you're really starting to get the idea that, man, I don't actually know that I'm the right fit for this, just be very upfront and frank about it. Don't just instantly come to the conclusion that you're not, or that the process is over, which I'll talk about in a second, but do mention it. Like, wow, I don't know if this is, I'm hearing what you guys are saying in terms of technology stack. I don't know that I'm 100% the right fit. Don't assert it like you already know that's a foregone conclusion. And don't think the interview process is over. Whether that, and again, you don't run into this very often. It's worth talking about. Whether you run into that occasion right here on the phone screen or much farther in during some kind of technical thing on the phone or on site, don't get all defeated. Recognize that the farther you get into the process, the more the overall thing is happening of they really like you. They want to bring you on. They want to find a way to make this thing work. I've had it happen occasionally where I wasn't a genuinely good fit for the role. And I got relatively far into the process and we started to see that. But they wanted me there. And it turns out there's other roles. Most often, it's another position that they weren't thinking of you for, but they recognize you're a better fit. And so they switch you over to a different group or a different role or whatever. And sometimes they'll create a role for you. It's been known to happen. So that kind of thing can happen, all throughout the process regardless, because when they recognize you're a valuable resource, they're going to start to think, where's the best person to put this guy or put this girl, right? But the whole point is don't get all down on yourself if it looks like it's not a good fit. Just communicate about it. Say something and see what happens. Often you'll be surprised. Okay, good. So that's a couple of do's on phone screening. Some don'ts. Don't ever, 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 ever interrupt this person. Don't ever do it. Don't ever do it. Don't do it on the phone. Don't do it in person. It's just bad manners. And it also shows you're not listening to them. Don't do it. Now, if this is something you struggle with, man, handle this during your mock interviews. Like on our job placement course, after you've done with that, you should be doing a lot of mock interviews. And if it's an area you struggle with, then attack it like you would any other area you find where you need improvement and drill it. Practice over and over again and let the person you're working with know that one of the things you're trying to get better at is a tendency to interrupt and have them call you on it. This will kill the interview process or this whole hiring process. And they'll do it for two reasons. One is you might not hear something that's really critical, and then you answer a question and you're answering the wrong question. And man, that's embarrassing. I'm not going to pretend I haven't done that before. It's embarrassing. But the second thing is that you're ruining the primary thing that's supposed to occur, which is they figure out that they like you. Why? Because it's not a very likable trait. Interrupting people is absolutely not a likable trait. It's not part of good manners in society. So I'm stressing this because I've seen it fairly often, and sometimes people aren't aware that they do it. But believe me, the person being interrupted is very aware that you've done it. Okay, now here's the big thing. Don't worry about things you don't know the answer to. Now, that's a really easy thing to say. And I know there's a lot of material in our job placement course that you do after technical study on your boot camp that addresses this. But I just want to stress it again. Man, if you were to add up the number of things that I know in technology, it's a big pile. It's a lot. I've been doing this since I was 11, and I'm 50 years old. But if you put a pile next to that of all the things I don't know in technology, I got a little pin dot of things I do know. It's unbelievable, the things I don't know. And I bump into it all the time. I subscribe to a lot of different technical blogs and that kind of thing. And every day, some technology will hit my desk or some kind of coding thing or whatever. I'm like, what is that? Now, I love finding out new things. I'll dive in. But the point is, I didn't know. And if someone had asked me about that at that point in time on a technical interview, I wouldn't have known. You're always going to be in that position. It doesn't matter whether you're brand new to the industry or you're experience. Now, yes, you have to get through the process and demonstrate that you have a baseline technical knowledge and ability and the knowledge of how to gain more knowledge and think like a developer. If you've got that, a certain baseline of technical knowledge and ability, and you can think like a developer and learn new things, you're golden. You're fine. But you're going to be asked questions you don't know the answer to. It happens all the time. It happens all the time for me. And it's okay. It's fine. You still have a way to salvage the interview and get hired. All right. And the last thing is, on a phone screen, don't talk about pay unless you're asked about pay, right? And the strategy on what to do about pay, there's lots of approaches out there. That's a lot of between you and your recruiter if you're working with one, that kind of thing. There's just the general, under do's and don'ts. On a phone screen, don't ask about pay. And frankly, I never ask about it until they ask. So it's a personal thing. All right, some do's and don'ts on phone interviews. And some of the ones I already covered definitely apply to phone interviews. Let's talk about some specific stuff, right? Same thing, do your homework, right? Do your homework before the phone interview. Be interested in listening, right? Same thing with taking the time to, understand the question you're being asked. But here on the phone interview, of course, there's going to be technical questions. And we're going to cover how to approach these technical questions, very, very practical examples in a few minutes here. But you need to become comfortable with finding ways to tell a story, opportunities to tell a story. You can just give an answer. It's a very factual answer. Yes, I use SQL Server version 2012. Or you can say, yeah, I remember using 2012 because it was the first year that they had this SQL Server data tools thing come out. And man, I love the idea of it, but in practice, it was really tough. So I'm really, really happy to be using 2016 or 2017 or whatever, right? So yes, they got the answer to the question, but one of them is a lot more exciting than the other and demonstrates more experience and understanding. Good. So how to tell a story? Man, we could talk about that for hours, but you need to identify those things. Relate a personal experience. Other things on the technical phone interview, because remember, this is different than the phone screening. This is technical, right? Don't interrupt. Again, don't freak out when you're asked about something you don't know. It's going to happen. And also, don't talk about pay unless you're asked. Now, let's talk about being on site, some do's, right? Again, same as the phone interview, do your homework, right? At this point, you might actually even know quite a bit, for example, about the specific technology stack that they're using. You might know, if they're using any, popular JavaScript libraries on the front end. You might be able to identify that. You might even know at this point, what version of the .NET framework they're using, right? So do your homework on this stuff. just dive in a little bit and try and get an understanding of, like, on a day-to-day basis, what are these developers working with? What does their day-to-day technology environment look like? Arrive early. Look around. Orient yourself to the environment. Don't be there rushed last minute. Be in the environment and just become comfortable in that environment. Also, we talked about this before, be interested in people, take time to understand the question, tell them the story. But here, especially on the on-site interview, this is your opportunity to show them how you think. And we're going to look at a practical example of that in a few minutes. But some aspects of this is to talk, you know, I almost wrote this even when I was putting the slide together, you know, talk out loud. Not that there's another way to talk that I know of, right? But you want to think out loud is what you want to do. You want to talk through your mental thought process. And I want to stress something really important here. And we're going to look at this in a practical example in a couple of minutes. But when you are asked, especially, a highly technical question, or more precisely, a question that requires some mental gymnastics, some creating in your mind a situation involving types of data and an operation you're going to do with them and an end result that you want and trying to figure out the recipe or algorithm or steps needed to do that whole thing. When you're doing all of that in your mind, there are some people that are extremely good at doing that all in their head. And then there's some people that can't do it without laying it all down on paper. This thing I'm going to talk about is more often a problem, frankly, for people that are, you know, much more capable of holding all that inside your head. I've seen this before. I've worked with people like this, and they look like miracle workers, like savants. They can just solve the whole thing inside their head and dump a fully finished answer right on the screen on a piece of paper. This is not the time to demonstrate that ability. It doesn't matter how cool it looks. Your job is to show how cool and how smart you are, although obviously looking for intelligence. Your job is to show them how you think. And since nobody can hear your thoughts, hopefully, if anybody can, I want to apologize. But because nobody can hear your thoughts, you have to tell them what your thought process is. You have to talk through how you're approaching the question, the problem. Even if you're mentally running into a barrier, communicate that. Talk through it. Man, I thought that when I processed this, you know, I ran through this whole set of items that I was going to hit some that met a certain condition. It looks like I'm not sure why. I wonder, literally, over talk. Talk through this. This is your opportunity to demonstrate how you think. And again, especially if you've done our program, by this point, hopefully you're learning how to think like a software developer, which is something, like I said, we stress pretty strongly throughout the entire program. But they're not going to know that if you don't say it, if you don't show that, if you don't demonstrate it to them. So talk through your approach. Again, tell a story with your answer whenever you can. Finally, in terms of don'ts, we've covered this before. Don't react negatively if something goes wrong a bit. On both sides, you're trying to assess the overall picture about the hire, and stumbling on a technical question is only one part of it. Almost as important as the fact that you stumbled is how you handle the fact that you stumbled. If your confidence goes out the bottom, if you're super embarrassed, if you lock up and don't proceed very well with the rest of the interview, they've just seen how you're going to respond to pressure, to something you don't know. And while it's not going to, like, be the make break of the interview, maybe, it does matter. So this is not something I can just tell you to do. This has got to be your own thing. I highly recommend just relaxing about this. Just get used to failure, man. Get used to being heard, you know, being told that's not right. Get used to being told no. Last job search I did, I went through 240 applications and about 18 interviews, and finally got my yes. I'm a very experienced developer. I'm very good at what I do. But they're looking for the right fit. And I was looking for the right fit. When I found it, it's great. It's awesome. All those other words didn't mean that I was an idiot or that, you know, there's something wrong with them, or no fault on either side. It's just not the right fit. Try to keep that in mind. I'm telling you, I understand. I've flubbed really bad interviews. It's embarrassing. But how you handle it, whether you show decorum, is really, really important. All right. So what do you do if you just don't know? And again, we said, you will be asked questions you don't have the answer for. Fine. It's absolutely going to happen. So what's the general approach? The first one is make sure you understand what the actual question is. If it's about a technology, what type of thing is it they're asking you about? And it's totally fine to ask that. It's totally fine to say, you know, I'm not familiar with Aurelia. What is Aurelia? I'm using this example because it came up the other day with a friend of mine. But what type of thing is it? And he said, oh, it's a front-end JavaScript framework. It's really lightweight. One of the things I really like about it, he said, is that it doesn't add a whole lot of, you know, size to your overall, you know, project. And it doesn't make a lot of the decisions for you in how you're going to handle presenting data in the web page. He did a really good job of explaining it. I'm like, oh, that's what that is. Now, if that had happened in an interview, I would have handled it the exact same way as I did over this casual conversation with my friend, because I was genuinely interested. What is this Aurelia thing? That's kind of cool. And I have done this, and I've seen others do it in technical interviews. They ask you a question, and you're like, you literally don't know what it is. It's totally fine to say, wow, I actually don't know what that is. What kind of technology? What is that? What does it do? And we're so used to the school academic environment, part of us can go, wait a minute, they're the ones asking the questions. We can't turn around and ask the question. Yes, we can, especially if it's something that's driven by your own internal, genuine interest and desire to know, desire to expand your knowledge level and learn new things. You ask a question like that and it comes from the heart, they're going to love it. And frankly, if they don't like it, if they're like somehow, you know, raising their nose in the air or they're a bit critical of that kind of thing, I wouldn't want to work with people like that. I want people working for me who are interested in life, in learning, in people, in finding out, in identifying things they don't know. So there we go. It's probably about enough about that, right? You can also, like I said, work out what they're trying to figure out by asking that question. See if you can, you know, give them that information in another way. And again, if you really don't know, just say that you don't know. Don't get all down about it. And here's the biggest thing. This is why I put it in caps. And this is true in these technical interviews, and it's just true in life, but especially as a technology worker. Finding something you don't know is genuinely an opportunity. It's an amazing thing when this happens. Now, when you're starting out in this industry, you can be like, well, Eric, I don't understand anything. So that's a really big list. But by the time you get done with the boot camp, you're actually going to know a lot. It's kind of interesting to, you know, look back on how you've learned. I highly recommend it. Or how much you've learned. I recommend it. But the point is, every time you identify something you don't know, it's actually an opportunity. You've got an opportunity to grow. And if you're so wrapped up in, oh my God, someone asked me something I didn't know, if that's where your attention is stuck, you're missing out on this opportunity you have. You have a really cool opportunity. So you should be interested in that. Like, what is this thing? How do you use it? What's it related to, right? Use, again, that example of, you know, my buddy bringing up this subject of this JavaScript library called Aurelia. That's that kind of thing, right? So this all comes down to one thing, and this is part of the core philosophy of the Bootcamp Tech Academy. We want you graduated, certain in your ability to learn new things, and able to communicate that certainty. We're not trying to graduate you knowing everything or memorizing a bunch of technology or syntax. Yeah, you're going to learn a lot along the way. But what's actually more important is for you to learn how to think like a developer and be willing and able to learn new things and to be able to communicate the things you're certain about. There you go. All right, so there are a few high-level types of technical questions. We're going to get into some actual examples here, right? And in general, this is just broadly the kind of like things that you can encounter. There's going to be computer science theory type questions. You get a fair, you know, a few less of those as a bootcamp graduate. They know that you didn't get a CS or computer science degree, but you're still going to encounter them. And frankly, you learn a lot of the core fundamentals of computer science along the way in any decent bootcamp, and especially ours. We spend more time on the fundamentals in any bootcamp I know. But the point is, you get asked questions about theory. They're testing understanding of how computers operate, the principles behind, programming in general, and that kind of thing. Then there's algorithmic thinking and design. Obviously, if the overall purpose of a computer is to take in data, process that data, and send it out, the most important aspect of that is the processing of the data. And that's done by computer algorithms, these recipes for working with data. They want to know not just that you're familiar with a bunch of the common ones that are out there. Like, we have some data on the early parts of a program about the different ways to sort collections of data, bubble sort, insertion sort, all that kind of stuff. It's very rare that those things actually come up as a technical question on an interview. But they do, and we've got really decent data on that kind of stuff, and you should review that as needed. But algorithmic thinking, how to actually work with data, process it, work with collections of data, the whole Boolean area of this, of if then else, this is a really, really common area to ask questions about during interviews. And finally, there's a whole separate section. We're not going to spend a bunch of time on this today because it's worth don't talk. If your job is going to involve relational databases in any way, shape, or form, and a lot of them do, we make full stack developers work on the front end of the browser and also on the back end, down the server and in the database, right? If your job's going to involve relational databases, they're going to ask you relational database questions. And some of them are going to be the theory questions, but a lot of them are going to be actual design. How do you work with relational databases and the tables in them and the relationships between them? We're not going to get into much of that in this one. All right, so let's look at an example. We're going to look at a computer science theory example. And the question would be, and I've been asked this, other people have been asked questions that are similar, can a class have more than one constructor? Now, why is this a good question? It's a good question because you have to explain a few things at the same time. Now, there's a bunch of stuff on the screen. Don't try to read it all right now. If you're trying to read everything on the screen right now, just stop. We're going to go through this one step at a time. And we'll be coming back to this page several times, and we're going to look at examples. They've asked you, can a class have multiple constructors? Well, to be able to talk about that to somebody, you have to understand, first of all, what's a class? And again, for those of you on the boot camp, this is probably review, but it's good review. And the way I'm presenting it here is a pretty acceptable way to talk about these things in a technical interview. They don't have to be super technical definitions. So a class is a blueprint for a custom data type. Now stop right there. A custom data type. Remember, any language you're using has a bunch of built-in data types, okay? So these are things like integers and strings, right? The more really common data types, right? And a data type is going to have some, properties, and it's also going to have things you can do with it, that kind of thing. When we talk about a class, we're saying, hey, you're the programmer, you get to make a data type. It's a custom data type. So a class is a blueprint for this custom data type. And when you write them down, you're giving them characteristics and behavior, and you're going to use that to create instances as objects, and we'll look at those words in a moment. The real, question answered here is, if I were a blank, what would I look like? What would I do? If I were a student, what would I look like? What would I do in terms of how a computer operates? So that's a class. Now, you also have to be able to answer this question. You've also got to talk about methods, also called functions, and lots of other words, but the point is, those are just a behavior. They show what a class can do. Not what it looks like, but what can it do? Good. And then there's parameters. A parameter is a piece of data you could give to a method that it can work with. And again, the thing is, these are not precise technical computer science definitions. They're not to be. And frankly, in a technical interview, that's not actually what they're looking for. It's not an oral computer science exam in a college. They don't want you to spit out exact word-for-word definitions. They're seeking understanding. They're looking for your understanding. And the fact is, a method is just one of the behaviors that shows what a class can do. And a parameter is just, that's data you can use to a method so it can work with it. Now we get into the instance. An instance, it's a real thing that's been created based on a theoretical design. And notice that definition has nothing to do with technology. An instance is a real thing that's been created based on a theoretical design. Now, whether you explain that definition or concept, you know, word for word in the interview is not important. And in fact, no one would answer this question with all of this verbiage you see on the screen. But answering the question of can a class have multiple constructors touches every single one of the things you see on the screen and opens up lots of room for discussion, conversation with the technical interviewer. And that's why it's important to know these things really well. We'll talk about them in simple, real-world terms. So now let's move down to an object. And now this is where it gets real, right? So an object is an instance created from that blueprint, the class. And it's got the behavior that was designed in the class, and it's got its own specific characteristics. In other words, it answers this question. Well, I am one example of a blend, and here's what I actually look like. Here's what I can do. I'm one example of a student, and here's what I actually look like, and here's what I can do. And lastly, we go back to the main concept communicated in the question. The question was, can a class have multiple constructors? What's a constructor? Well, it's a method in a class. Typically, lots of methods in a class. But this method, this is a method that describes how you make one of those. If I'm going to make, you know, look back at the word of instance, a real thing that's been created based on a theoretical design. If I'm going to make one of these things, how do I do it? I want one now. How do I do it? So, again, we're going to look at all this in code in a second to really bring these things home. Because there's lots of ways that you can demonstrate understanding. So, a decent answer to this question, and again, let's go back to the question, can a class have more than one constructor? Decent answer might be, yes, here's why. And you can explain a little bit of those concepts above. But you also just want to say this, like you might want to control how fleshed out an instance of a class is. Okay, good. So again, you might want to control how fleshed out an instance of that class is. You want to customize it based on what you're trying to do in the program at that time. The way you customize this fleshing out is you build more than one constructor method in that class, each of which takes different parameters so that you can use the one that fits the data and the need you have at the time. So I'm going to show you this in code so we can talk about it in a bit of detail. Good. So first of all, here's class, and this is a student class. So this is the question, if I were a blank, what would I look like and what could I do? If I were a student, what would I look like and what could I do? Well, the what would I look like is here on lines 3 to 6. This is like, if you're looking at a student and you're looking for significant information about them, well, their name and their ID and what their grade point average is, that would be some significant characteristics of a student. So then there's, what can I do? Well, look on line 8 here. We have a method defined in here called format full name. And this format full name isn't given any data, doesn't take any parameters, but it does return something. It does give you something. When this method is used, it takes the characteristics of that student called a first name and characteristics of that student called a last name and puts them together with a space in between, just like you would actually format a full name. So this is the question. Let's go back for a second. If I were a blank, what would it look like and what could I do? Well, if I was a student, this is what I'd look like, lines 3 through 6, and this is what I can do. Now, one of the other things that you can do is to make a student. This is a constructor. Notice it doesn't even have any return. This is just, at least in the language C#, this is how you make a method inside this class. And when you use it, it's going to make one of itself. Great. Now, you might have cases where you want to make a student and you already know what their GPA is. So why not make a constructor method in here where you can actually set that GPA when you're creating a student? And same thing, you might be making a new student and you've already got their name. And so you want to be able to change the characteristic of that student you're creating at the time you're creating it to already have its first and last name. it. So now let's look at what that looks like in the real world. Like, again, to go back to this, we need to make actual objects, an instance created from the blueprint. So, and it's got its own specific characteristics. Let's look at how that's done. So here's just the base constructor, the one that you get for free whenever you make a class. We're going to make a student. We're going to call the student student, because that's a real imaginative name, right? A lot of creativity there. And it's going to be created using this method right here. Like, that method will actually get called. So you have this object called student being maintained in memory. And in terms of characteristics, it's got a first name, a last name, a student ID, and a grade point average. Now, we haven't done anything to those, so this is an empty string for first name and for last name. This integer is probably defaulting to zero, depending upon what language you're using. And this integer, same thing, probably defaulting to zero. But it's ready to be done. It's ready to be worked with. You can take this student object right here, which is being maintained in memory in the computer, and you can start to change its characteristics. You can set its first name. You can go student dot first name equals, well. So now, on line 36, you've made the object from the blueprint. And on line 37, you're starting to change its characteristics. And again, this is all review, depending upon where you are in the boot camp. And the point is, when you're answering technical questions, it's amazing how much understanding can be, you know, fished for in a discussion about something this quote-unquote simple. You can check so many things, right? Okay, so this is the name of a variable. Man, you could go off on that. They could start to ask you questions about, well, like, what is a variable really? And now you've got to start talking about memory in the computer and the fact that you have these, literally, you have binary digits that can get stored in the computer, and you can have a set of them that are all, you know, physically next to each other that are allocated to store whatever value happens to be in this, you know, variable called student. And that's a lot of data has to be there, right? And then you can say, well, they can say, well, how do you identify that specific, you know, set of data in the memory? And you say, oh, well, there's an identifier. The identifier is actually student. And so student is stored somewhere else, and it points to all the memory locations that contain the data about itself. You can get really deep on this. And that's not what the purpose of this tech talk is. We're not going to get super deep. But the point is, asking these kinds of technical questions, they can seem pretty simple on the surface. And frankly, if you give a nice, great answer to it right off the bat, they might just skip it and go, okay, yeah, well, he or she clearly knows that. I can just move on. But just as often, an interview will dive in and go, okay, well, let's examine that a little bit. And again, it isn't that they're quizzing you and wanting to know if you know all of this stuff. They're just checking, is the baseline understanding there? If you're not perfect on an answer, but you get the overall concept, they're going to be fine with it. So let's finish up this little discussion, because we get to go into the coding exercise in a moment, right? Notice that there are other constructors, and I've shown examples of how to use the constructor that, you know, actually has a GPA. Remember, it's up here. This is the constructor to create a student where you pass in a GPA, and you make the characteristic or property called grade point average equal to whatever you gave it. So you could create a new student, and as soon as you're done with this line right here, it exists in memory, and its GPA, its grade point average property, is already set to, let's say, 3.2. Okay, good. Same thing with, you know, the names constructor. You can call that constructor and give it these names, and now it exists in memory, and its, you know, first name and last name strings are already set to Eric and Chris. So how would you access the behavior? We talked about the characteristic. This is what I look like. But also, there's what can I do? Well, I can format a full name. So this is how you would do that. You would want to create a variable called display name, and you take the object. Again, this is not the class student, because the class doesn't exist. The class is a theoretical concept. This is the object, the actual instantiation of that student class. We call it student with a lowercase s, and we're going to use the behavior on it called format full name. And it's going to look internally to itself for its characteristics called first name and last name, put them together, and return those things together with the space in between as a string. And that's going to be assigned as the value of this variable called display name. Again, lots of review there. But notice how much fun you can have in that and how many questions they can ask you and they can just see if you understand the overall concept. I did this one in C#, but frankly, you can write this in pseudocode and it wouldn't matter. It'd be just fine. Now, algorithm thinking and design. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to use FizzBuzz. Now, a lot of you have used FizzBuzz. I forgot to capitalize the B on that. Sorry about that. FizzBuzz is very common. If you haven't heard this word before, we're going to explain the whole thing. It's just a really common example, right? So read this typical assignment right here at the bottom. You have a collection of integers. Read that whole thing. Okay, good. So why is this used so often? Well, it's used, you know, as a gut check, high level, can the person actually write code? And it shows if you can think like a computer. And we're gonna demonstrate that. Okay. So let's look at this nice little console application that I built. Now I'm going to enlargeify the text on here to make it a little bit easier for people. Okay, good. Awesome. So we're looking at an example of FizzBuzz. And again, I put in comments here as the assignment. So I want to stress something. I'm going to show you all of this in code. And it's a working program. And we're going to look at several different steps in the evolution of the final version of it. I'm going to talk about the thought process behind it. Often when you're asked to do this, you're just asked to do it on a whiteboard. It doesn't even have to be working code. And that's fine too. What they're really looking for is what I referred to before. How does this person think? And can they actually write code? Even if it's pseudocode on a whiteboard, they'll be able to see that you can write code. Good. So the assignment is you want to loop through an array with numbers between 1 and 100. When the number is divisible by 3, you want to print fizz. When it's divisible by 5, print buzz. And when it's divisible by both, you want to print fizzbuzz. So there's a pseudocode solution right here. We're not going to look at that in a bunch of detail right now. So I'm going to move it up for a second. I'll tell you why. When you're asked questions like FizzBuzz or other algorithmic thinking questions, you have an opportunity to demonstrate how you think. And I don't want you to look at a fully fleshed out solution to this and go, oh, well, there it is. It's all obvious. I want to instead show you how you can break this down one tiny step at a time. You might not actually do it this way. You might do it this way. It depends on the situation. But if you think about it in this one step at a time point of view, you'll be able to communicate very clearly how you think. It isn't so important just to come up with the right answer on this, although you do want to get the right answer. You want your code to actually produce the right output. But you also want to be able to demonstrate again how you think. So the first thing we do is a little bit of housekeeping just to make this work. I created an array called array, right? And it's populated with the numbers from 1 to 100. Now, I'm going to put a little breakpoint here, and we're going to run this. And you can see if I roll over array and look at it, index 0 has the value 1. Index 1 has the value 2, so on, all the way down to the bottom where index 99 will have value 100, okay? Now, just in that little thing I showed you, recognize that there's plenty of discussion that can happen with you in your technical interview, right? Well, wait a minute. Why is it index 0? Why wouldn't the first index be 1? Well, it totally depends on the language you've chosen. Many languages, in fact, most of them, the first element in it is numbered 0. But there are, in fact, languages where the first element is numbered 1. This is a good thing to know because, look, this seems like a really simple exercise. It really does. It's FizzBuzz. You're not going to do this in the real world. This is not a programming assignment that reflects, you know, an actual piece of enterprise-grade software that manages, you know, a multinational company. But the errors you make in writing something like this are the same errors you will make in writing those big giant pieces of software. They involve simple things like not fully understanding what the collection of data that you're working with looks like. How is it structured and what can it do? Little things like that. Working with a collection of data and being off by one. Man, these things do matter. And the fact that if you're able to talk about them simply and clearly with some intelligence, it tells your interviewer that you understand these fundamental basic concepts. They know if you do that, especially for these entry-level positions, they know you're going to at least produce code that works. Can it be refined? Yes. We'll look at that a little bit later on in this coding example. But they know you can write the code. Good. So we now have an array to work with. That's not BizBuzz. That's not the coding exercise. I had to build that so we can show you how the coding exercise might work. So go back here. Press a number, key or whatever. Okay. Oh, it wants me to continue. Fine. All right, good. So let's get rid of that breakpoint. And now let's make sure that our loop actually works. I'm going to go through my loop, my collection called array. Oh, sorry, I want to make sure that my array works. So let's go and look through here and make sure that I've actually got all the right data. I saw it in the debugger. Oh, no. Okay, good. So, again, element 0 contains integer 1. Element 1 contains integer 0, so on and so forth. All right, good. So, go down to the bottom here. I have a working version of this that isn't commented out, and I don't want to have that go on. So, the first thing is this. I want to print the whole loop. I've done that. I made sure it works. And I want to now solve the divisible by 3 part. And again, you might be able to solve this whole thing in your head. The brighter amongst the members of the audience probably have already solved it in their head. That's not what you're interested in a technical interview. They want to see how you think. So I might go something like this. Well, I want to solve just the divide by 3 part first. So I'm going to make a loop. It starts at a counter of 0 and goes until the counter is less than 100, because I know my length is going to be 100. And then what I'm going to do every time, I'm going to check the element of the array that we're looking at, and I'm going to use this thing called a modulus. Now, for those of you not familiar with that operator, it means check the result of what's left over after dividing by the number after it. In other words, if I have 9 modulus 3, I take 9 divided by 3, there's none left over. But if I do 10 modulus 3, well, it goes in 3 times, but there's 1 left over. So the modulus is 1. So the answer to 10 modulus 3 would be 1. Okay, good. Awesome. So again, to answer this question in real code, you would have to know about the modulus operator that's used in that language. If you're doing it in pseudocode on a whiteboard, you can say mod or modulus. But the point is, I'm going to check first and just solve, hey, can I output here every single item that actually meets the conditions of being divided by 3 and only 3 with a remainder of 0? So I go to the top here, and yeah, 1, 2, and then yeah, 3 is divisible by. Okay, good. And then, okay, good. That's divisible by 3. Excellent. So it looks like everything that's divisible by 3 works because every third thing we print fits. All right, it looks like that works. Great. All right, well, now I want to solve the divisible by 5 part. And again, this is super simple, but if you're doing this for someone in front of them, they have plenty of opportunities to ask you about your thought process, why you're doing it. So I'm going to then write something like this. I'm going to check the mod 3, I'm going to check the modulus 5, and if it doesn't, then I'm just going to print something out. Okay, good. Now let's just run that, see how she looks. And look at this. Go to the top, so it's much easier to think with. Yeah, 3 is divisible by 3, so it says fizz, 5. Let's look at 9, yeah, divisible by 3. And then you go, 15, yep, there's our problem. 15 is divisible by both. And this is why FizzBuzz is created, is to see if you can just think with, how do you do that? So you might do something like this. And comments went out. again, this is super simple code. The thing to be demonstrated here is not, ooh, can we write, you know, look at this wonderful code. That's not it. You're taking a simple, you know, coding exercise, and you're demonstrating to the person how you think. And that's why this approach of let's break this apart into little bits of pieces is such a good idea. So now let's look at this whole thing. Divisible by both 5 and 3 part. Okay, good. So here, look at line 76. I'm going to check for a logical AND, that's a Boolean AND. Is it divisible by both? Great, now print fizzbuzz. Otherwise, else if means otherwise, well, how about 3? Great, print fizz. Otherwise, how about 5? Great, print buzz. Otherwise, just don't do nothing. Okay, good. So there's a lot of opportunity here for the person to ask you, well, why did you put this check for both of them being true first? And why not check this first? Well, what if you have the number 15? If you put the 3 check first, it's going to print fizz. And then it's also going to match this condition of both 3 and 5 being divisible. And so print fizz buzz. And it's going to match this one. So the order in which you put these actually matters. This else protects you. It's not going to run that if this first one is true. But if you put any of these first, then you're not going to catch it the right way. So again, lots of discussion opportunity. And that's what you're looking for in these technical interviews. It's not just, okay, I answered the technical question exactly right, and I'm going to move on to the next one. If they're in dialogue with you about your potential solution and your thought process, that's a good thing. If they're challenging you to explain why you did a certain thing, it's not even necessarily because you screwed up. You may not have screwed up at all. They just want to see how you think. Okay, good, fine. So that's that. Now, they might ask you if you got it exactly right. Well, what are some, you know, better solutions? What are some other ways you could do this? So one thing is this, is if you know that the language you're using has a construct called for each, then set up your loop without using this integer counter right in here, right? But instead, use this nice for each. It makes it easier to read. That's kind of nice. You can rewrite it that way. Again, it's a minor thing, but if you had done it this way, with this kind of a loop, and they ask you how you might make it better or refine it, you could say, well, I could do a for each loop. It makes it a little bit easier to understand, easier to read. You're not dealing with this, you know, clunky array element I kind of thing. You're just going, well, is the item modulus 3 equal to 0? It's a lot easier to see at a glance what this thing does. So that's a, quote unquote, better solution. And I'm going to cover one last one, and then we'll be wrapping up. So here's an outside-the-box solution. You might get someone who really starts this out, and I'm going to say something. The scenario I'm about to describe doesn't happen that often, and when it does, they're not really expecting you to get an answer, and they're not disappointed if you don't. It's usually the case where you've really worked through something, you explored a lot of different angles on it, and you've done a pretty good job with it, and they could finish right then and everything be fine, and they're like, you know what, let's go for a little bit of icing on the cake. Is there a different way you could do that to make it even more refined? To use less code? Less code. To use less else if statement? How'd you do that? Well, look at this question here. Did they say we had to print the numbers that don't meet the specs? Did they say go through the numbers 1 to 100, printing them off? Unless they're divisible by 3, in which case print fizz, or they're divisible by 5, in which case print buzz, or if they're divisible by both, print fizz buzz. They didn't say we had to print the numbers. Look at the original assignment. When it's divisible by 3, print, but it just says loop through it. So what if you did this? Oh, wait. Wrong one. You got outside the box. Look at the output of this bad boy. It's this big long string right here. Now, the fact of the matter is that this actually meets the qualifications. Let me show you. You don't print anything on one, you don't print anything on two. You get to three and you print this first fizz. You get to five and print that first buzz. You get to nine and you print this fizz. You get to 10, print that buzz. 12. And look right here when you get to 15. There's a fizz buzz. There's a fizz buzz in there. It actually works. And now, this is a bit like, dude, that's nerdy. Come on, really? But the fact is, you were given a set of specs for the algorithm, and you accomplished the exact thing the algorithm is supposed to do. All of these other solutions, and there's nothing wrong with any one of these solutions. This is a perfectly fine solution. All these other solutions, and we'll run one for a second, what they do is make it very easy to verify that you got the algorithm right. That's all they do. That's all they do. They make it very easy to see, well, he checked the number one and made sure they didn't meet any of the three conditions, and it didn't. He checked two and didn't meet any of the conditions. He checked the number three, and lo and behold, it met one of the conditions. And again, there's nothing wrong with this answer. This would be a perfectly fine answer, and it accomplishes everything we've talked about during this talk today. It demonstrates that you have a certain baseline understanding of computers and programming. It provides a really cool opportunity for you to talk about the actual, you know, business of processing data and how to manage collections of data. It shows that you can literally shows that you can write code, and it would be a perfectly acceptable answer and would work fine. If you ever encounter anything like this madness, if someone really wants to go down that road, you're dealing with somebody, if they treat you kindly about it, if they're nice about it, they're not like, man, you should have thought about that. Now you're dealing with somebody that you're going to really want to work with because they get it. They get real coding versus an academic exercise. You've got to have an academic exercise, some pretend mocked up thing just to be able to figure out, hey, does this candidate actually have what it takes? The real coding is stuff like this, where you look at the actual spec and you go, oh, what's the most efficient and readable way to actually get that done? There it is. Two lines of code, really. Well, four, because you got to print them on the screen. Okay, good. So let's open it up. The floor is open to you.
So personally, I was wondering, how do you get in that mindset for coding, and how do you practice those algorithms or whatever you may need to understand to actually conquer those tests that they offer?
Yeah. So the mindset thing, you should really review the overview of software development course, in particular the sections on how to think like a developer and on abstract data types versus concrete data types. If you look at that section right in there, I mean, there's a lot of data on the overview of software development course, right? But the sections on how to think like a developer and then on the difference between an abstract data type and a concrete data type, there's so many examples in there of how to think with things algorithmically and how to think with creating your own custom data type and defining what it looks like and how it'll operate, the kinds of things it'll do. So that'd be my recommendation in terms of our curriculum. In terms of just the practice part of it, there's lots of really cool sites online, like HackerRank and that kind of thing, to just give you these mock-up pretend assignments over and over and over again, and just stick with it without peeking and looking at the answer. But also, my recommendation is, if you're really grinding, spinning your wheels on something, then look at the answer, figure out how they do it, you'll learn something, and then move on to the next one. So those are my two pieces of advice for that. Does that help?
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you.
So,
hey,
question is, what is the what is your once when you're asked a question that you don't know in an interview, what is the best way to respond?
I say, well, I say something like this, like, you know, at first glance, I don't know that I know the answer to that. I want to make sure I understand it. Can you give me a little more background data or, context? I'll give them an opportunity without freaking out to be able to give me a little more data. And sometimes they're like, no, that really is just a pretty straightforward question. If you don't know it, that's fine. I'll say, okay, totally understood. I'm not familiar with that. If it seems like they're willing to communicate about it a little more, I might dive into what I talked to you about during this presentation of going, what actually is it? Like, what kind of technology is that? And sometimes they're totally willing to go, oh, well, it's a block. And sometimes you can tell that they're really not, you know, into talking about it and they want to move on. It's totally fine. Just let it go. But that's how I recommend it. And then very often, if I have the opportunity to say it, I'll say something like, especially if I found out what type of technology it is, I go, wow, yeah, unfortunately, I haven't bumped into that so far in my career. I have worked with blank. It's relatively similar. I'm not too worried about picking that up and being able to hit the ground running with it in short order. So that's how I approach that.
Got it.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I had a question.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of interested or invested in my first tech job being one where they have a culture of learning and fostering their employees to be better engineers. And right. I'm curious what a good way is to approach that with an interviewer or how to get an idea of what the situation is like. Because, you know, I don't want to end up here's your cubicle and no one's there to help me. And
yep, that's beautiful. That's really, really good. So I'll address a high-level aspect of that first, right? I want you to get everything you want out of your first job, okay? Just a piece of friendly advice. If you're getting into your job search and you're just really not finding what you're looking for, and I'm going to talk to you about how to identify it in a second, but if you're just not finding it, but you find a company where you like everything else and it's just not as strong as you might want in that area, then jump on it and trust yourself to learn and figure it out. Just be prepared to burn the midnight oil a lot and pick things up. But that said, you can get what you want. I want you to. And here's how I would approach that. You want to ask questions about their onboarding process, first of all, right? And then I always ask that. Like, well, what's your onboarding process? When you're bringing on a new developer, what do you do? How does that process work, right? And you're going to learn a lot from that. You're going to learn whether there's a formal process for it or not. All too often, it isn't really a process beyond the physical IT infrastructure setup. They'll start going into things like, you know, well, you'll fill out your form to get, we'll get you configured for an email and a phone system and that kind of thing. And you might get a security fob and blah, 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 blah. They're talking about physical infrastructure. They're not talking about how do you do the best job possible of orienting this new technology worker, particularly if they're a new developer, to the system on a broad, high-level view so that they know, at least from a 10,000-foot view, what we're doing and roughly how it works. That's the question you're trying to get answered when you ask about their onboarding process or orientation process or initial education process. Any way you phrase it around that, that's the thing you're trying to find out. So that's one aspect is you want to find out as they bring a person on board, how good of a job do they do of that orientation to the overall system, you know, the broad landscape of what our software is and does. And again, in very broad terms, how do we as developers do our job? So that's an area, you know, that's the way you can find out about that without being really blunt, like, I just want to find out how, you know, can you tell me how good of a job you do in bringing on new people? Don't. Just ask how they do it. What's your process for onboarding? The second thing, and I love what you're asking about, you want to find out about the culture of learning, right? There's a couple of different things you can ask about. You can ask about, do you guys have any sort of like an informal sort of mentorship program? Make it very open-ended like that. Just informal kind of mentorship kind of thing. and just let them talk and find out. You'll find out very quickly whether or not they even give a crap about that. Sometimes they just don't. And that's your answer right there. Like, yeah. Or they might say, you know, this is what you hear more often. It's, we don't have anything really formal on it. But what we do is generally, you know, with those first few months, we're just going to ask someone to kind of be your buddy through it, right? We want you to have someone that you just turn to when you, you know, have the inevitable questions, really kind of just get a quick answer instead of spinning your wheel. And that's a beautiful question to learn, or to answer to get, okay? Every once in a while, you might get, you might hit the, you know, the mother lode, find the holy grail, and they have a firmly, exactly established track of learning, and you're not even going to be like coding for the first 2 weeks. They're going to send you to a school where they teach you all about the company and its history and an orientation on the IT department and blah, 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 blah. That doesn't happen very often. But if it is that way, they will probably already have told you about that because they know they have something really cool and really valuable, and they're going to want to sell you on that as part of the process. So that's my response to that. Does that help?
Yeah, a lot.
Okay, good, cool.
That's great. Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. Anything else? I'm open to whatever you want to ask.
We have a question from Mark. If you have a non-technical person conducting your phone screening, what is a good question to ask them at the end of your conversation that doesn't relate to technical aspects of the company?
Oh, beautiful. Now, I want to say, again, big picture, whatever you ask has to be your question. And has to be driven from your point of view and your interest, okay? That said, I'll just tell you things I commonly ask because they're things I'm interested in. I'm like, I ask, what's it like to work there? It's very broad, very wide open. What's it like to work there, right? And you're not asking in an accusatory fashion at all. You're not asking, you're like, you just want to make sure there's no, like, you're not on your back foot on this. You're genuinely interested. What's it like? You know, you can also ask, like, how long have you been there? Ask them, you know, that. Like, if you're genuinely interested in that person, about anything about that person that relates to their job, ask them about it. You know, how long have you been doing HR there? Like, I'd be interested in those kind of things. So, again, there's no set pat answer for that one. But it has to be driven by your interest. And what you're wanting to do is ask an open-ended enough question, you know, that they just start to talk about it. Like, you can just say, like, I've done this one a lot. What's the culture like there? It's so wide open. They can talk about anything, right? And you can learn so much about not just the specific data that they give you, but how they answer it. If they don't answer with a lot of enthusiasm, they don't have a lot to say about it, well, then you've got a bit of your answer right there. But if they answer with a lot of enthusiasm, even if it's about something that seems to be on the surface totally unrelated to what your job is going to be in the IT department. That what it shows, though, is the culture is dynamic and vibrant, and people like get passionate about something. So you learn something right there about it. So that's how I would handle that. So this is me again. Your answer, your question for somebody has to be from you, from the heart, from your own interest and desire to know something. Does that help?
Awesome. I think so. Cool. If you have more questions about that, Mark, feel free to follow up. We have another one from Scott as well. If you don't have a college degree or that four-year foundation of computer science fundamentals, besides the overview of software development course, what is the best way or resource to build that foundation?
Okay, so, well, the high-level answer to that is there's no one best way, okay? I will say this. This goes back to a talk that I've been delivering since we first started the school about how to break into the industry. There's three broad categories. I'm not going to spend a bunch of time on it, but I'll give you a high-level view here. You can, of course, do the computer science degree, but we've already ruled that one out with the question. You're not going to spend 4 years getting a computer science degree. You can do self-study. Now, if you're going to do self-study, and there's pros and cons to each one, we're not going to get into a bunch of pros and cons, but if you're going to do self-study and not a boot camp, there's some decent resources. One of the ones I really like is freecodecamp.org. FreeCodeCamp is great. They have a really good product. I can't knock it at all. Even though obviously I'm biased, I co-founded a boot camp. Right? They're a great program. It's really great. Okay. Also, there are several decent channels on YouTube that actually do a really good job with the fundamentals, right? But the chief challenge you're going to have, I said I wasn't going to get into pros and cons. I tell you, one major challenge with that route is knowing that you're studying the right things if they're going to get you hired, and finding simple enough explanations for these highly technical concepts you're going to encounter that you don't get lost, buried in an avalanche of misunderstood technical words and concepts. So that's one way. Again, like I said, I like Free Code Camp. There are going to be others for self-study. And, of course, there are boot camps. And, again, I'm extremely biased, but we have a phenomenal boot camp. So there's a bunch of different options on that. There are places that are in person. There are places that are fully online. When you're trying to find one, the things I recommend you look at are, one, longevity and track record, because the industry's been around for 6 or 7 years now, right? Two, are they tied to one specific technology and they don't address much of the underlying basics of computer science and fundamentals of programming? And then three, can they talk to you about their outcomes? How well have they done in actually getting people hired? Examine those factors. So again, that's a high level view. That's the subject we talked about for about 30, 45 minutes. It's all the different ways into the technology industry. Does that help? That was for Scott, right?
Yeah, that was for Scott.
Actually, yeah, I have a quick follow-up to my question from earlier. When you're asking about, when I'm asking about the onboarding process, would that be done during the screening or later, a little later on?
You know, that's something you're going to want to ask at least halfway to two-thirds of the way through the whole process. I wouldn't do that on the screening at all. It's way too early on the screening process. And if you're on a technical phone interview and it's gone really well, I might ask that when they open the door to you and say, what questions do you have? Yes, that might be an opportunity to ask about that. Like, how do you onboard things? That's a real good place, is that technical phone interview. If it's, you know, gone some length and if they're comfortable giving you time to ask a few questions of your own, then ask it then. Otherwise, the in-person interview in the building is a great place to ask that. So I would say anytime after a phone screen, you might want to start delving into that question. But play by ear too. I mean, you might have a phone screen that starts to go a little bit deep, and you can tell that they're really into you. They like you a lot, and they're probably going to put in a really good word for you. And if you're curious, then ask them then. You know, but in general, after the phone screen.
Thanks.
Another question from Scott here.
Yeah, sure.
Through your experience, Eric, most important thing to part on a resume. Towards the top to catch their eye. Excuse me. Through Eric's experience. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, I can answer that. So first of all, if you go to our boot camp and you do the job placement course at the end of it, there's a tremendous amount of extremely valuable guidance on this. We've gotten hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people hiring, right? So I'm going to give a very short answer to this. There's a lot more data out on the internet you can look at, but you asked from my experience. From my experience, the most important thing to put at the top of the resume is what I would call a skills summary. It's not a job history. It's not chronological at all. It's sort of a 3 to 5 to 6 bullet point list of significant accomplishments that paint a picture of you as a whole. It's types of things you've done, not exact instances, if you know what I mean. Like, let's say you have farther down in your resume on the chronological history, you've got 5 different places where you built web applications, and they were in like 3 different business domains, healthcare and financial services and manufacturing or whatever, right? You might have a bullet point in that skills summary I'm talking about. It said, created robust web applications in many business sectors, utilizing both front end and back end technologies such as React, C Sharp, and SQL Server. So you've described a category of type of work that you have done. You're not listing specifics. You're not attaching it to any specific point in time. It doesn't say whether you did that 20 years ago or whether you did it last week. It's just a type of thing you're good at. And you can probably think of 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 more of those. I have about 6 or 7 at the top of my resume. And what they do is, at a glance, they paint a picture of you. The broad types of work that you can do, the broad types of business domains that you have experience in, from healthcare to finances or whatever, the broad, like, organizational skills you have if you've been a team lead or anything like that, so that in reading about, you know, 50 or 60 words, someone can get a decent picture of who and what you are. So I recommend putting that at the very, very top before you list out your exact skill set and before you list out your chronological record, so that you said at a glance, well, at a glance, they get a pretty decent picture of who and what you are. So that's my answer to that.